I want to say welcome to everyone here. Welcome to our visitors. It's good to have a bigger crowd today. So God is blessing us. I have just a few announcements, well, quite a few. First of all, there's an insert in the bulletin about the Lake Tahoe camp meeting. Go ahead and read it. I've been going for the last 5 years, and it's a lovely camp meeting. If you want to go, you have to call. If you want reservations, you have to call the Lake Tahoe. Well, it's on here. The Tahoe Valley Campground. To get reservations for campsites, you call them directly, or you can make reservations at the many hotels in the area. But if you want to go and stay overnight, you need to make reservations soon because they fill up really fast. Also, today we have a fellowship luncheon, so all of our visitors and all of our members are welcome to stay. So please plan on staying. We have a lot of food, I hope. There usually is. The prayer meeting on Monday. It was voted to change the time to 6 p.m. So starting this Monday, prayer meeting will be at 6 p.m., led out by Marge Barber. Also, we have Bible studies at the Gleason's home on Tuesday at 7 p.m., studying the Gospel of John. And Thursday, the pastor's Bible study is at noon here at the church in the library, and we are studying Revelation. It's a very good Bible study. And also we have the emergency food distribution every Thursday from 9:30 to 11:30 and 4 to 5. And we're seeing a lot of people that are really grateful that we're doing it here as a church. Next Sabbath is a women's ministry meeting following the worship service. So all the women here, please remember that and come prepared to stay for that. There is a religious liberty offering. We will continue to take that for one more week, I believe. So if you need a little religious liberty handout and folder, they're in the foyer. And they're on the desk. And you can find those easily. Also, beginning March 7th, beware because Sabbath school will be starting at 10:30. The worship service will continue at 12 noon, but Sabbath school, we will have more time for Sabbath school. It starts at 10:30 to 11:50, so remember that. That starts March 7th, so we have a couple more weeks. And I think that's it. We'll go ahead with our praise music.
Oh, I'm sorry. Let's turn to page 92. I forgot it wasn't on the bulletin. This is my Father's world.
This is my Father's.
Rocks and trees, a
let's turn to 633. That'll be our next song. Let me see if I can't get that before the pianist. It's 108, and I believe it is Amazing Grace. I want to hear you all sing out now.
I see. Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name, Master.
Him. Oh, don't tell me.
Praise God.
Please bow your heads for opening prayer. Heavenly Father, merciful Savior, we come before you this holy Sabbath day, a day that you have set apart so that we can bathe in your glory and give honor to you, the living God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. Great and marvelous are your work, O Lord God, the Almighty. Just and true are your ways. Lord Jesus, pour out your Spirit on us and cause us to revive and grow into the fullness of Christ. We pray this for the glory and honor of your name. Amen. Please remain standing for our opening song, page 579.
Mind it makes us kind together every day. happy. 'Tis love that smooths the way. It helps us find, it makes us kind to others every day. And when our life is over, and when we're called above, our song shall be
Welcome, Sherry Ann and Anderson. I have a story for you. There's some more offering. There you go. Okay. Well, one day, this story is about a little boy named Tony. And he's about the same age as you are, Anderson. Well, one day Tony's grandfather was visiting him, and he gave Tony a silver dollar. And that is what a silver dollar looks like, but it's not that big normally. It's usually about that big around. I was hoping I had one, but I couldn't find one. But Tony, he was very happy. He kept looking at it. He would turn it over and over. It was so pretty. It was shiny and bright. He thought of the many things he could buy with it. Could you buy something if you had a silver dollar? You could. Candy. Oh. Well, then Billy, he put it in his pocket and he went outside to play. It was a beautiful day. Tony had so much fun riding his bike and playing with his friends. Later that day, Tony, reaching into his pocket, "What's up? It's not there. Where did it go?" He looked everywhere. He looked around the house. He looked around the yard bin, but he could not find that silver dollar. He was pretty disappointed, wasn't he? Well, he began to cry. I have a picture of him crying here. Tony felt so badly. He began to cry, and he was so down in the dumps, he just decided to go to bed. Why stay up? He was really upset. Well, Tony was so unhappy that he didn't even take time to pray. As he tried to go to sleep, a still, small voice seemed to say, "Tony, you didn't pray." He would turn over and try to forget it, but pretty soon he would hear the same still, small voice, "Tony, you didn't pray." Well, finally, Tony decided, if I'm not going to sleep, I might as well get up. Maybe I had better pray. pray after all. Tony climbed out of bed and knelt down on the floor beside his bed. Ouch! What's that? His knee was pressing down on something cold and hard. What do you think it was? It was his silver dollar. Tony would have found his silver dollar earlier if he had just knelt down to pray when he went to bed. So he had to keep praying instead. Well, he learned a lesson, didn't he? Jeremiah 33:3 says, "Call to me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you do not know." And God certainly showed him, didn't he? He showed him where his silver dollar was after all. So God does answer prayers of even little boys like you, Anderson, and little girls like you, and also bigger boys like Cameron. We just need to pray to him because he wants to answer our prayers, doesn't he? So let's pray to Jesus right now. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for the promises that you have given us, that you want to hear our prayers, and that you are just waiting to answer them. We just thank you for always being there. We don't have to wait for any particular time. You're always there, and we just need to come to you. Amen.
I like 309 because I'm from the 209. That's where I was born again in Christ, down in Stockton, California. It's a 209 down there. Everybody got a 209 phone number. And then I just threw 100 on top of that, and it's 309.
Jesus, I surrender.
Thank you, Jesus. Woohoo! Yeah, keep going. Keep going.
Morning and happy Sabbath to all. At this time, we will have our time of prayer, time for us to seek the Lord together as a family. I'd like to invite you to kneel with me as we seek God together and come into his presence. Father in heaven, we are gathered here this beautiful sunny afternoon to lift the name of Jesus and to bring glory to your name. We thank you so much for waking us up to see another day. Great is your faithfulness towards us. We thank you so much for the opportunity to gather together in this building, Lord, and to worship you in freedom. We thank you for the relationships that we have developed here, Lord. We thank you for Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. We thank you for sending him so that he could die as our substitute. Lord, we thank you for the privilege of being able to celebrate that great gift today and look forward to the day when we will dine with him at that great feast in heaven. Father, we come before you knowing that we are sinners. We are sinners, fallen short of your glory. And we come with the Spirit asking that you would forgive us and not only forgive us, but cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And we claim that promise. That if we confess, you are faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us. So Lord, we come before you humbly seeking your Spirit to fill us so that we may continue to do your will in this community. We thank you for opportunities for ministry. We pray, Lord, that you would open our eyes to more opportunities, that we would see where you are going and see what you are doing and what you desire for us to do. May we submit our will to your will. May your will be done here in Penn Valley as it is in heaven. Lord, we want to take this time to pray for the many concerns that are among us as a family. Some are sick, some have other types of concerns, Lord. And just want to take a few quiet moments for us to lift those concerns up to you. So, Father, we praise you, we adore you, we love you, we thank you, in Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Our scripture reading for today comes from Luke 6, verses 37 to 42. Luke 6, 37 to 42. Judge not, and you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. And he spoke a parable to them. Can the blind lead the blind? Will they not both fall into the ditch? A disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone who is perfectly trained will be like his teacher. And why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not perceive the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, "Brother, let me remove this speck that is in your eye," when you yourself do not see the plank that is in your own eye? Hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck that is in your brother's eye. Bless the reading of his word.
Aren't we blessed to be able to have the freedom to come together and worship the Lord? And it's so important that we do this while we can. And this is what the offering is about today. It's for our local conference advance, to put money in so that the gospel can be carried in our own conference. And have I played my part well? This was the last question of Augustus Octavius, one of the most celebrated emperors of Rome. He was also a contemporary of Jesus Christ. Yet the two could not have been more different. Augustus boasted that he found Rome in brick and he left it in marble. Jesus left the center of the universe as God to save humanity by embracing human frailty. Augustus was a man of war, commanding legions, while Jesus was a man of peace, healing broken lives. When death was near, Augustus asked those close to him if his life had any meaning. He famously asked, "Have I played my part well in this comedy called life? If so, applaud as I exit." Augustus knew that there is more to life than conquest, riches, or glory. Jesus also knew that the greatest gift in life is one of service, lived for the benefit of others. We see Jesus in the Bible healing, feeding, and reviving people. Let us do as Jesus did and serve our communities with our time, talents, and financial contributions. Today, our offerings serve the various ministries of our conference. Let's give generously. Jesus reminds us to seek God's kingdom first, and all other things will be given unto us. Will the deacons please come forward? Dear Heavenly Father, we know that you are in control, that you are Almighty God. And as we give our offerings to you today, I pray that you will take it and multiply it abundantly so that people in our conference, no one will miss the hearing of your word and hearing of the gospel. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good afternoon, saints. It's good to be in the house of the Lord today, and sorry for being a little late. I must admit I was probably a little long-winded at my last location and got me here just a little too late. I'll do better on that. Today, we are celebrating the Lord's Supper, and I would like to, for us to take just a look at one of the sayings of Jesus about what it means to be a citizen of the kingdom of heaven, what it means to be a citizen of his kingdom, of the kingdom of God. Because as we celebrate this, this is a reminder of the bond we have not only with one another, but the bond that we have in Jesus Christ. So it's only appropriate that we look at just one aspect of what that means, and we'll be looking at Luke chapter 6. But before we go any further, let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Lord in heaven, may the words that I speak be seasoned with your love and grace. Lord, open my lips so my mouth may declare your glory. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Open with me in your Bibles to Luke chapter 6. Luke chapter 6. Luke chapter 6 is a brief retelling of the Sermon on the Mount, Beatitudes, and some of the great wisdom that Jesus gave on that sermon is here in Luke chapter 6. Now, at the beginning of Luke chapter 6, or towards the middle of Luke chapter 6, what we know is that Jesus is addressing his disciples. He's talking to them about what it means to be a follower of his, what it means to be aligned with the kingdom of God and to put away the things of earth. And he says some really, lack of a better word, salacious things as he's talking here, at least in their mindset and in ours too, about how they should act towards one another. He's describing principles of what it means to be citizens of the kingdom, what it means for the love of Christ to rule in your heart. It should be what drives our decisions and what is the foundation of our relationships. You know, he starts off in verse 27 of Luke chapter 6. I want to start in verse 27 because you can't really start with verse 37, which is what was read for our scripture reading, without going back to verse 27, because even more, as I use the word, salacious than judging one another is the aspect of what is talked about here in Luke 6:27. I'm going to read it, 27. I'm going to read through 31 for now. It says, "But I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, and pray for those who spitefully use you. To him who strikes you on one cheek, offer the other also. And from him who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who asks of you, and from him who takes away your goods, do not ask them back. And just as you want men to do to you, you also do to them likewise." It's interesting here that he talks about enemies, and he defines in the scripture what exactly an enemy is, if there's any question about what that might be. People who curse you, but the terminology here is that really, I think, drives home for us in our day and age is verse 28. Pray for those who spitefully use you. Who likes to be used here? Who likes to be taken advantage of? You do, Mark, sometimes? Most people don't like the aspect of being taken advantage of, knowing that people are taking advantage of either whether it's their generosity or whether it's their kindness or whether it's their resources. Most people are willing to give, but you can tell when someone is towing the line and taking advantage of that which you are freely giving to them. And here's what it's saying is those who not just use you, I said use you, but it says spitefully use you. Use you, that's a different story, right? That use you with evil intent. Use you not thinking of you at all. What Jesus is doing here is he's describing definitively, this is how you define an enemy. These are individuals that you don't get along with. These are individuals who are purposely and knowingly seeking ill will against you. These are individuals who have bitterness and hatred in their hearts against you. They're not seeking your good at all, but only what is evil against you. And he is saying it is these individuals that you are to show love for. Now here's something else. He says to love them.
I say to you, verse 27, I say to you here, love your enemies. Sometimes we take that word love and think of it in terms of a feeling, an emotion, something you just say, you know, Eric, I love you, man. You know, something you could just say to someone without really thinking about what that is. But Jesus here again, he defines what he means when he says to love your enemies. He's not talking about saying you love the person and then paying them no mind. Instead, he commands, he gives commands or words to describe what this love looks like. Love your enemies. The next phrase, do good to those who hate you. To do good to that individual. Again, bless those who curse you. To bless means to speak not only well of, but to speak highly of. It's been rare to hear, and myself included, hear someone who does ill to me to speak a blessing on them, to speak highly of that individual. Usually you're told if you have nothing good to say, right, don't say anything at all. But here the Bible's telling us to bless those who curse you, to speak well of them. And then it continues on in verse 30. It says to give to everyone who asks of you, the one who's taking advantage of you. And then it says to pray for individuals who are not in your good graces. So we see we are to do good, we are to bless, we are to pray, we are to give to individuals who are not in our good graces. This lesson is telling us that living as a Christian means that we act out our Christianity. We don't just say it, we live it. And we don't just live it to those who are, those we get along with, but to everyone. We never sit and wait for someone to treat us kindly before we treat them with kindness. The section about loving your enemy ends with a command. And in verse 36, I'm going down to verse 36 because I want to get to verse 37. I'm just setting the stage for this aspect of what he's talking about in verse 37. It says in verse 36, therefore, be merciful just as your Father is merciful. That word mercy, also meaning compassion, showing compassion for those who are opposed to us. Compassion for those who don't have our best interest in mind. Compassion for everyone. Our hearts need to yearn for that individual, for those individuals. Now, after speaking this about their enemies, and the disciples were very familiar with this whole aspect of enemies. Remember, they were always there when they saw the way that the Pharisees were treating Jesus. They saw the way that the Pharisees and the Sadducees were plotting against him and never had his best interest in mind. They were trying to trap him. They were even trying to kill him. And yet, they saw the way Jesus acted towards them. And here, he's telling them and showing them why we need to do that. Now, after speaking about this behavior, Jesus goes into another type of behavior, one where it goes into the aspect of judging one another and what it means to judge one another. Verse 37. I'm going to read our scripture reading, verse 37 to 42. Here's what it says. Judge not, and you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. And he spoke a parable to them. Can the blind lead the blind? Will they not both fall into the ditch? A disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone who is perfectly trained will be like his teacher. And why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not perceive the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, brother, let me remove the speck that is in your eye, when you yourself do not see the plank that is in your own eye? Hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck that is in your brother's eyes. Jesus goes into behavior here about how we should relate to one another with issues of judgment. He was speaking of that harsh criticism that his enemies were giving to him. You see, this passage follows directly after Jesus instructs his disciples to love not one another as they're developing a relationship with one another, but to love their enemies, to love their persecutors, to love the ones who were not on their side. Can't escape the conclusion that Jesus is teaching his disciples from personal experience. He's dealing with false condemnation from the Pharisees who are increasingly attending his meetings. They're going to his miracles. They're watching to see what they can find in order to condemn him, to judge him. Jesus was explaining to his disciples how he himself deals with his enemies. You see, friends, what Jesus is talking about here is not the discernment that is necessary for survival. Those are tentative assessments meant to guide our immediate actions. What he's talking about here is the outright condemnation and sentencing that we should leave to a court of law. It's dangerous to make pronouncements about people, to slander them to others, to roundly criticize them in public, because we run the risk of misjudging them. You know, it's interesting, we look to people and judge them, but one of the things that we need to realize as we're looking at this text is our judgment is never complete. We always look at people from a certain perspective, never understanding the completeness of what they're going through. Why doesn't that individual come to church on time? Why are they never attending these meetings? God knows what's happening outside. We sometimes, as we look and perceive things, we're only perceiving it from a certain perspective. We have half the story. The first pair of negative commands here tells us his disciples not to be judgmental, not to be condemning, not to be blaming, not to be fault-finding, not to be critical. But then he moves on as he talks about that. He tells them how they should be. He tells them that they should be forgiving, that they should be generous, that they should be merciful, that they should be gracious, tender-hearted, just as God is to them. Sometimes people are naturally critical and negative. If you talk to my wife, she would probably tell you that maybe I'm a little negative sometimes as I sit and think about some of the, not this church, but some of the other things that are maybe happening, and she may tell you in confidence that my husband he tends to be a little bit on the critical side sometimes, and maybe as I was preparing this message, I'm looking to myself. But I would guess, friends, that the environment as far as being forgiving and judgmental and distrustful, it becomes a learned behavior. Too often what happens is we learn the wrong lessons from hurts that we have suffered. People have come and judged us and said things against us, and then we just turn around and give it back to them or give it back to someone else. Instead of going to Jesus for healing, we accept that bitterness and distrust instead. And go about after that, scarred and guarded and not willing to open ourselves and be a community of faith. But if these positive traits, the ones that Jesus are talking about here of giving and forgiving are definitely spiritual, Jesus is calling his disciples to follow after the Spirit. Teaching us to love our enemies, teaching us to forgive those who hurt us, instead of judging and condemning our enemies. We are to be giving to them. This is to be an attitude and a lifestyle for us. And if it doesn't come naturally to us, that's when we turn to Christ and ask him to fill us with his Spirit. Verse 38, give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be put in your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. In the same way that you treat an individual, if you're forgiving of them, it will be come back to you. If you're judging of them, it will come back to you. This is not God sitting on the throne, watching and waiting for you to see if you're going to be forgiving or if you're going to be judging. This is a law of the universe, friends. We reap what we sow. It comes back to us, whatever we sow. And this text of Scripture, Jesus is talking to his disciples. He's trying to create a community. And in doing so, he's telling them that this is the way you need to live with one another. You need to have a forgiving spirit. Because if you don't, you're just going to sow seeds of bitterness. And there will be no unity among you. You will not be able to spread my message to the world. This is an important message that he gives to his disciples, an important and pertinent message that he gives to us today, because if we too do not embrace the aspect of forgiveness that God is calling us to embrace, we will find it to be difficult to do the things that we desire to do for his honor and glory. We'll find it difficult to live our lives according to his will and according to his plan. There's nothing more painful than to just have that bitterness in you and not be able to reach out to someone and solve those issues. Today we're celebrating the Lord's Supper. And one of the aspects of the Lord's Supper is just that. It's coming together, hearts of gratitude and praise for what God has done, but also hearts that are unified together, wanting to meet Jesus, wanting to share in what he has done as a unified front. So today, as we partake of this, let us not forget the words of Luke chapter 6. I didn't want to be too long today because I wanted to have time for the Lord's Supper. But let us not forget the words of Luke chapter 6. Not just to love our enemies, but also to be giving, to pray for those who persecute us, to be forgiving, and to allow those principles to be part of who we are. It's a custom in the Seventh-day Adventist Church that we have open communion. That means if you believe that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ is the Lord of your life, then you are welcome to participate in this event. First, what we do is we have the ordinance of humility, which is foot washing. It reminds us to be submitted to one another. And we're going to separate for that. The women will meet in the fellowship hall. The men will meet right in the nursery behind the sanctuary area. Families will meet at the end of the hall to the right. And we ask the children stay with their parents. We're going to take time right now to separate. If you, for whatever reason, would not like to participate, just invite you to stay here and just have a moment of silent meditation as we have the ordinance of humility, that we will come back and we will share in the Lord's Supper. Let's have a word of prayer before we separate. Our Father and our God, we're just so thankful for the love that you give to us on a daily basis. We're thankful for Jesus Christ, the author and finisher of our faith. We're thankful for the words of instruction that he gives to us. We're thankful for his example of love and forgiveness. Lord, as we remember, as we contemplate these words of Jesus, Lord, may the heart of Jesus be within our hearts. and may his mind be in our minds. And may this celebration today draw us closer together and closer to him, in whose name we pray. Amen and amen. Let's now separate.
Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14 to 16, my favorite text about our compassionate and loving Savior, who is also our compassionate and loving high priest. It says, "Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." As I read this, it just reminds me that Jesus went all the way for us. He did not hold anything back. He gave his all for us. And we're going to sing before we go in. To our time of the Lord's Supper, we're going to sing the song, the hymn, "All the Way," to remind us as just as Jesus went all the way, we also want to go all the way. That'll be hymn number 516, "All the Way." Thank you.
I will be reading. I will be reading from 1 Corinthians 11, verses 23 and 24. 1 Corinthians 11, verses 23 and 24. It says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" If you are able, please kneel as we come into the Lord's presence. Dear Lord Jesus, as we take this bread, the symbol of your life, may we remember your sacrifice for us. We pray for the gift of the Holy Spirit to bind us together in love, in unity, and in purpose. We ask for these blessings, Lord, that we may glorify you. Amen.
John 6:51 was a troubling words for the people of the day to understand. But for us, we understand. It says, "I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world." Let's partake of the flesh.
Similarly, when supper was ended, he took the cup also, saying, "This cup is a new covenant, ratified and established in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it to call me affectionately to remembrance. For every time, we shall remember him. Let us kneel. Our precious Heavenly Father, what a privilege it is to come humbly before you, Lord, to acknowledge what you have done in our behalf. You whom shed the blood which represents life, a perfect life, a spotless lamb without blemish, giving his all for us. What a blessing, what a privilege, what grace. It abounds abundantly. Lord, we accept it. We pray that we give you glory and honor in this, and we acknowledge you for being our Lord, Savior, Redeemer. And we ask for this in Jesus' name.
Similarly, Jesus said in John 6, verse 56, "He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him." It is a reminder of our ability to abide in Jesus Christ. Let us partake of it. Scripture tells us that at the end of the supper, they sang a hymn and they departed. For a hymn of departing, we're going to sing number 350, "Blessed Be the Ties That Bind Our Hearts in Christian Love." Hymn number 350.
Let us stand as we sing. Will be at the door. They will have an offering plate. We'll be collecting an offering to for the poor in our community, and that's something we do during this time of communion. Let us bow our heads for the benediction. Our kind Father, we are just so eternally grateful for who you are and what you have done. We thank you for this time once again to share in this supper, a reminder of what is to come, a reminder of what was. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for dying. Thank you for rising. We give you glory because you reign, and we look forward to the day when we will reign with you, and you will be leading out in this supper. But until that day, Lord, may we continue to do this, and may we continue to proclaim your victory over death and over sin. And each time we do this, Lord Jesus, come quickly. We pray in your name. Amen and amen. Please be seated.